So the answer to the puzzler is, if you take M to be all of matrix A, then N is the zero vector, and therefore M inverse times N is the zero matrix, and therefore this right here becomes zero. And then actually you end up converging in one step, one iteration. So that brings up the question, what actually is a good splitting? Well, it's not just that you want this norm to be small, but it's also important that solving with M is cheap and that multiplying with N is cheap. Okay, now if N is just some submatrix of A, usually what happens is that N is a sparse matrix and therefore multiplying with it is cheap. That's good. And then what made the Jacobi iteration so nice? Well, solving with a diagonal matrix, especially when the diagonal matrix is just four times the identity, is particularly cheap. So that's good. It's convenient. Similarly, for the Gauss-Seidel iteration, solving with a sparse lower triangular system is cheap. So that's convenient. And then we saw that, you know, even though the splitting matrix for the symmetric Gauss-Seidel is quite a bit more complicated, in practice you can think of it as solving with two sparse triangular matrices. So that's convenient as well. So there's this delicate balance between picking an M and N such that this coefficient that tells us how fast the iteration converges is small, and making sure that you can conveniently do the computation, conveniently meaning cheaply. So let's think about this a little bit more yet. Okay, what makes M inverse N small? Okay, the way I always think about it is that the more matrix M resembles A, the smaller the norm of M inverse N is. Okay, so you're looking for a matrix M that is similar to A, and that's actually why symmetric Gauss-Seidel is nice, because not only is M reasonably close to A, but it also resembles A in the fact that it's symmetric. Anyway, that's the kind of thing you look for in a good splitting. A matrix M that resembles A, and as a result, hopefully, M inverse N is small.